Good evening, everybody out there in Facebook land, Zoom land, wherever you may be. Welcome to another episode of Please Educate All Children Equally, Education for Liberation Friday. Tonight's topic will be From Dreaming to Planning to Doing. This is also in recognition of today's ancestor, Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., who actually today was his birthday. I know we celebrated this coming Monday, but today would have been his actual birthday. We have an awesome panel here of brothers, and I'm gonna introduce them to you. I'm gonna get right into it. I have to tell a little joke first, though. We just chopped it up a little bit, and these guys, you know, even though I didn't play during the times that they did play in college football, they played for a couple of colleges that you just give it the business, man. But I still love them nonetheless. I still love them nonetheless. But let me give them a shout out right now. First, we have James Keith McLaughlin, who loves God and people. He hails from a long line of preachers, including his father, Reverend Dr. Wesley K. McLaughlin, his mother, Reverend Pamela H. McLaughlin. James earned a Bachelor of Science degree in Business Administration with a concentration in marketing from Bloomsburg University in Pennsylvania. James then continued his studies at Bloomsburg and earned a Master's of Business Administration his degree. Jameson acknowledged the calling to preach in 2010 and immediately enrolled in seminary. James graduated from Wesley Theological Seminary with a Master of Divinity degree. While at Wesley, Jameson was awarded the Margaret Pittman Award for Ministerial Excellence in Urban Settings. Jameson also earned a Master's of Theology degree in Biblical Studies at Princeton Theological Seminary. Jameson is currently a PhD candidate in practical theology at Regent University. Good evening, Brother Jameson. How you doing, sir?
I'm well, blessed to be here. Thank you again. This is my second time on this wonderful show, and I thank you for the invitation. Much respect to you and to the other panelists, two brothers that I respect to the utmost, and I'm grateful for this dialogue, very relevant, very necessary conversation.
Yes, yes, yes. Next one is a guy that I've known for God, like 30 years now, a little over 30 years, ever since 1987. That's not this show. This show is not about that. But I've known this guy since 1987. Let me get into it right here. David A. Rosario was born and raised in Philadelphia, PA. After graduating from the renowned Central High School in Philadelphia, David attended Westchester University on scholarship for football and basketball. He graduated with a Bachelor of Arts in Communication. David also holds a master's degree in educational leadership from the venerable HBCU Lincoln University. Okay, we got to talk about that too. Enthusiastically pursues learning about ancient African history. David has spent parts of the last 25 years working in and around Philadelphia as an educator and advocate for youth and families. He has worked in several school districts, charters, and in the behavioral health community over the years. He currently works as an administrator in an elementary school in Philadelphia. David is a champion of children and families in needy communities. He has been a volunteer football coach for the School District of Philadelphia. David has also volunteered with the Salvation Army and in various community centers and churches. He is a proud member of the Omega Psi Phi Fraternity Incorporated. And just put that out there, all three of us are. So awesome. Dave, thanks for coming this evening, sir.
Brother Warren, anytime. You make the call, I answer.
Hey, that's what it's about right there. So listen, we're gonna get right into this conversation, man. And the world, you know, right now is going through a whole lot. It's going through a whole lot right now. We're gonna dialogue about some of that. I'm gonna share a video first. And let me know out there if in fact you can or cannot see the video. Because sometimes, you know, Facebook gets a little tricky with stuff like that. But I'm gonna try to share it with you. Okay, this is a video, it's very apropos. This is a video that I actually saw in the New York Times. And so we're gonna play it for those who may not have seen it. get rid of this ad first and then we'll get started. I'm not trying to advertise this company, whatever this is. Okay, here we go.
Let me be very clear. The scenes of chaos at the Capitol do not reflect a true America. Do not represent who we are.
Are you sure about that, Joe? An armed standoff? White male entitlement? Conspiracy theories? Sounds pretty American to me. Just look at this guy.
This is not who we are as a nation.
This is not who we are as a country.
It's not who we are. We're better than this.
We may be shocked by pictures of a mob invading the Capitol, but check out the paintings hanging behind them in the rotunda. We shouldn't be surprised, because we've always been like this. America is a nation built on stolen land by stolen people. And if Wednesday's rampage feels historic, it's because violence is in our national DNA. A mob raised a whole block in Philadelphia because they didn't like, you guessed it, the election results. And after Lincoln was elected, the South launched a civil war rather than accept peaceful transfer of power. Those Americans dreamed this flag would fly in the halls of the Capitol, but it never did until now.
They don't get to steal it from us. They don't get to tell us we didn't see what we saw.
Taking up arms when you lose an election? That's American tradition.
I look to history, to the precedent of the 1876 election, the Hayes-Tilden election where...
Glad you remember that one, Ted. That was when Black Americans were subjected to a century of Jim Crow terror, a trade-off for electoral peace. An hour after your speech on Wednesday, while you cowered inside, they hung a noose outside the Capitol. And Black people cleaning up the mess? That's another all-American tradition. This is where centuries of white entitlement leads.
Oh, there we go.
Storm the Capitol and meet hardly any resistance. A cop is not a threat. He's a photo opportunity. And instead of a jail cell, you toast your criminality in a hotel lobby.
We are watching an attempt at a bloodless coup in the United States.
Closest thing that I can think of that this reminds me of is the time I spent in Iraq in 2007 and 2008.
These aren't foreign insurgents, they are us. They shop at Walmart, they watch the Super Bowl, and they're not going anywhere.
We were normal, good, law-abiding citizens, and you guys did this to us! We want our country back!
And for the purest expression of the American way, just look at the man responsible for Wednesday's violence. A man who leads by Twitter, who knows that if you have enough money, they'll let you do anything. He told us who he was, and we picked him, because this is exactly who we are.
And after this, we're going to walk down, and I'll be there with you. We're going to walk down.
America, land of the snake oil salesman.
Let me be very clear. The scenes of chaos at the Capitol do not reflect a true America.
No, Joe. This was a perfect distillation of everything America is and has always been. Your platitudes been a fantasy as absurd as QAnon, that repeating, this is not who we are, will somehow make it true. Of course, this isn't everything we are.
The 82-year-old hands that used to pick somebody else's cotton went to the polls and picked her youngest son to be a United States senator.
Just hours before the violence began, Georgia elected its first Black senator. But we can only realize our strength if we stop whitewashing our sins. We are a nation forged in racist violence, a society that values wealth over wisdom, a country where personal ambitions mean more than morality, masked with false piety, where citizens wreak havoc on the very institutions that enable them. And get the t-shirt too.
This is the United States of America.
So, you know, we could have a whole entire conversation just about what we just saw in the video. You know, shout out to the New York Times for what they did in putting that little video clip together in their opinion section of their newspaper. Let's just talk about that for a second. Just that video clip we just watched. What are your thoughts, brothers?
So I'll start first. The conversation for me actually picks up where we left off on the last time I was on this show. Frederick Douglass was challenging the nation for its hypocrisy, and in particular, the church and so many others who claim to be American yet are filled with hypocrisy, hatred, and bigotry. And the cycle happens over and over again. And so to be as bold and audacious to make the statement, this is not who we are, this is exactly who we are. History continues to repeat itself. And the question comes, how do we create change? How do we ignite change? How do we make something different for the future generations? And I argue, rather than complain about what happened, take action like Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. Be one of those few people, I want to be clear, few people who are bold enough to address injustice and empower your community. I believe Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. was what Frederick Douglass talked about when he said, we need more people speaking up, more preachers, more teachers, more leaders, more community leaders addressing the injustice and not saying it's okay. And so it is infuriating to watch people in storm the Capitol. It is perplexing to see people be that upset about losing. I mean, we tell kids, all of us played sports on this panel, and we tell kids you got to be able to take victory and defeat, treat those two imposters just the same. Yet we see people upset about losing a fair election. And so we wonder about the level, I keep hearing the term white privilege or privilege. We wonder about the level of superiority complex where people feel they are so much more superior than others. It brings a lot of thoughts to mind. And I just say, we have to call things for what they are rather than just sit by and say, okay, no big deal. Okay, we recognize this is who we are. How do we address change? That's what I think of.
Okay. Absolutely.
My thoughts on that is it is who this country is. There's no doubt about that. The only difference is that the narrative that used to be controlled is no longer controlled with the advent of social media, the advent of photography. You know, the narratives was controlled through the world wars. Before photography, the narratives were controlled in the publishing. You know, yellow journalism and things like that, slants and things like that. Now the narrative is controlled by sectionalized viewing or what is that thing called? What are those things called? Analytics. When you programmable watching, you had that lady who died because probably everything that was filtering into her was stuff that kept a self-feeding machine. She watched whatever wing she was on and it kept feeding her that stuff and feeding her stuff. She got a 100 channels that can feed her that all day, and then your psychology goes that way. I'm not surprised to see a noose up there. I'm not surprised to see Black people cleaning up the mess once again. I'm not surprised to see police officers taking selfies and opening, and say, come on in, like it's a bullfight, ole, come on in. None of that surprised me. As a Black man, I knew it was my turn to sit this one out, you know, and just sit back and watch this situation. In the spirit of Dr. King and being agents of change, we've had examples, and we actually have an example. One of the examples that we had was Tulsa and Rosewood and other Black communities. Those were the examples. Those were financially adept people. Those were community builders. Those were people who were self-sufficient, and they were self-sufficient to the point where it drove another culture crazy. And did what they did. We know what the history books say that they did, and buried it because they, again, controlling the narrative. They controlled the news, so it didn't get out for a long time, 80 years, I think it was, beyond that localized geography. But I caution you to look at, well, I invite you to look at the Asian community. If you notice, the Asian community doesn't really get into a whole bunch of politics. they get what they want because they know how to lobby. However, they are self-fulfilling their own situation with their own business, their own import, their own export. If you go down in different cities in the country, they have their own language on this on their signage. I mean, when I was a young guy, it was in English. Now, a lot of the signage is just in their own language, but they're powerful. They're not making a lot of noise politically, but trust me, their money speaks and their power and their business acumen. I'll leave it with this. I've always said that if 100 citizens wanted to get an audience with the president, whoever the president is, it wouldn't happen, but an audience of 100 business owners would.
We're definitely going to get into that in a second, man. Good points, both these brothers, in terms of ownership, right? Ownership, business, you know, economic power, economic freedom, all those kinds of things. I mean, money talks, and it definitely does. We're going to get into that in a little bit. I just want to open up with that video because when I saw that, you know, that's what's going on right now. And that was before we had, you know, basically put this show together for this particular week. But definitely. So from dreaming to planning to doing. So we're going to get into that right now. I'm going to play a little excerpt from the great late ancestor, Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King, the video. So let me pull this back up and share my screen again. And let me go here, go there.
I have the pleasure to present to you Dr. Martin Luther King, Jr. I am happy to join with you today in what will go down in history as the greatest demonstration for freedom in the history of our nation. American in whose symbolic shadow we stand today, signed the Emancipation Proclamation. This momentous decree came as a great beacon light of hope to millions of Negro slaves who had been seared in the flames of withering injustice. It came as a joyous daybreak to end the long night of their captivity. But 100 years later, the Negro still is not free. 100 years later, the life of the Negro is still sadly crippled by the manacles of segregation and the chains of discrimination. 100 years later, the Negro lives on a lonely island of poverty. I have a dream that one day this nation will rise up and live out the true meaning of its creed. We hold these truths to be self-evident that all men are created equal. Yeah. I have a dream that one day on the red hills of Georgia, sons of former slaves and the sons of former slave owners will be able to sit down together at the table of brotherhood. I have a dream that one day even the state of Mississippi, a state sweltering with the heat of injustice, sweltering with the heat of oppression, will be transformed into an oasis of freedom and justice. I have a dream. My one day live in a nation where they will not be judged by the color of their skin, but by the content of their character. I have a dream. And nullification. One day right now in Alabama, little black boys and black girls will be able to join hands with little white boys and white girls as sisters and brothers. I have a dream
still to this day, you know, when you hear something like that,
one of them,
it still gives you like the chills, right? You know, and that particular you know, speech, you know, I have a dream. And so that kind of segues into our talk this evening about having a dream. You know, some of the things that the great ancestor said, it says, he starts with a discussion of a dream of history. He points out the significance of the place and time of the protest, the Lincoln Memorial. One century after Lincoln delivered Emancipation Proclamation, King notes the enormous progress set into motion by Lincoln's proclamation, but states that 100 years later, Black Americans still were not free, facing discrimination, segregation, poverty. You know, the country's founding document promises all Americans to the right of life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. But for Black Americans, this promise has proven to be a bad check. You know, by his account, you know, civil rights activists refuse to believe that equality and justice are limited and resources, and so have come to cash out their check regardless. So still to this day, as we know, all the things that have been going on, you know, recently and for years, and for me, that's 2 years before I was born. So, you know, we were looking for that back then, and we're still looking for a lot of it now. Yeah, we may be doing better. We can do this platform. You know, we have careers, jobs, you know, businesses, whatever the case may be, but we're still facing some of the same things. So that was the dream 57 years ago, when he made that speech. And still to this day, we're still faced with many of those obstacles. Maybe legally, you know, segregation and discrimination might not be on the books legally, right? But in practice, a lot of those things still take place. So let's talk about that for a minute. What should be our plan? We've been dreaming. What should be our plan? What we got to do?
I think the table, having seat at the table and rewriting the documents that we're utilizing to as a platform, I think we need to revisit that. When he talks about using the Constitution, as we mentioned before or in previous episodes, most of those people who wrote that document were slave owners, right, were known racists, and did not have the African American community or the Black community in mind. And so while there were obviously white Americans in the audience supporting the movement, believing in the movement, there were still a lot in America who were descendants of those forefathers who were totally against us having equality. And so I believe using documents like the Constitution, while I believe it's great, I also believe if we're going to have this nation truly live out equality, we need to revisit the wording and those who are at the table making the decisions, and everybody, not just Black people, but Asian Americans and Latin Americans and so many others need to have an equal say in what are the guidelines for our community. That, to me, that's a start. And still there are cultural norms that will take centuries, maybe generations, for there to be a change. But to me, we need to revisit or go back to the table and redraw out with all people in mind when we're writing these documents.
Yeah, man, that's a bad check. He said it's a bad check. And so we got these documents, we got these, like you just said, the policies and procedures of how the country's supposed to run, but it wasn't written with everybody in mind, right?
Right.
And going back to what we saw last week, it was written with people, unfortunately, to have that sort of mindset in mind. Those people, as bad as it was, those people that were at that Capitol last week, many of them, not all, but many of them, probably most, especially the ones that broke in and did the things that they did, they have some of that mindset from the original founders of the country that owned us, that owned our ancestors. Let's just be honest. They had that mindset, right? And it's unfortunate that it still exists in 2021, you know, but you heard them say, let's take back the government. They're taking our country. Let's take back the government. I mean, what are they saying when they're saying that? You know, they want to go back to making it great again. When was it great for us? Right? I mean, really, we have some good things, doing some great things here and there, but overall, it was not created with that in mind for everybody, right? So in order for it to really authentically be that, we need to start with the documents, the rules, the regulations, and make it for everybody.
That's right. Yeah. That's right. So, yes. You know, Dr. King mentioned a bad check, and he's 100% right. But my thing is, it shouldn't have been a surprise that it's a bad check because we worked for free. Why? They never gave us a check. And if they were going to give us a check, it darn sure wasn't going to be a good one. You know, so we have to introspect and change our narrative and our approach. We keep pouring into a system that has never poured back into us. Okay. We've always been in that servile place. We're the blue collar, we're the hardworking folks, because yes, we have education, yes, we have those that have ascended, yes, we permeate all kinds of spectrums, but in a space that they define what we are a part of. They define what a bachelor's degree, what a high school diploma looks like, what a master's degree, what a salary cap looks like. All of that stuff is defined by those in power. We have to go back and accept that we were brought here in an agricultural society. okay? And we know that story. But then the country shifted. Shifted from agricultural to industrial. But what are we going to do with all these agricultural people now that we're in industrial? Now that we have immigration and we brought in other skilled people, well, we're not going to let them get into unions, because once the unions start, they kept us out of the unions. They kept us out of the factories. So you have this group of people that they kept defining what they want to do with us. So 13th Amendment, okay, we'll start locking some of them up. We'll start doing birth control. We'll start population control. We'll offer Planned Parenthood to the women. We'll incarcerate the men, and we'll stop the birth rate. We'll do lots of things. That's the whole cooking up. And we're not doing any cooking, because we're still knocking on their door, asking them to be civil and human and all of this other good stuff. I will go back to the examples of the Native American. Some of our Jewish friends partnered with the Native American friends and taught them how to uplift themselves. They taught them how to look at the books to say, hey, you guys were supposed to get 3% of anything they found once y'all signed those crazy treaties. Well, they looked at the books and it was nothing but a bunch of IOUs in the Department of the Interior. So the Jewish friends went to the Native American friends and showed them how to go cut a deal and get their money. Now you see the rise in the Native American community with hospitals and universities and casinos that don't pay taxes. So they're not really banging at the door asking for anything, because they're internally building their infrastructure. You know, you got Chinatown, you got other kind of town, but you don't have no Africa town. You know, we're not internally building anywhere on this country. And that's where we need to go and introspect and start beginning to trust each other and do some cooperative things, economics and business, financial literacy, buy some land, put some things together, all of that stuff. It may not all happen in our lifetime, but that's where we need to be going and stop knocking on that door, asking them to do something for us.
Amen. I couldn't agree more. Self-sufficiency really is the way. About 10 years ago, I kept hearing a phrase, model minority, in reference to Asian Americans, because they have so much wealth in their own communities. And as Brother Rosario mentioned, Chinatown, and I'm not trying to be insensitive to the plight of Asian America, but it's definitely not the same as the plight of Black America. But we seem to be the main minority asking for equality, knocking on the door for justice. But when we focus on our, and I'm not saying everyone is like that, but I believe when we focus on our community, supporting our own businesses, educating our own children, having knowledge of self, taking care of our own families, whether it's healthcare or what have you, I think we'll be in a much better position. To me, that's the dream. Not asking someone else to help me, but being able to take care of ourselves.
You know, I want to add one other thing, brothers. I like to peruse social media when I have some downtime. And what I do specifically, I go on different platforms and see how the messages are being sent. There's some young brothers and sisters, I'm speaking like Instagram in particular, that have built some serious followings and they've made some serious money. And specifically redirecting the thinking of younger Black people, whether it be for financial literacy, whether it be for understanding real estate, you know, and those are small little successes to show you that if you reinvest inside of ourselves and our mind and our young people who are frustrated, and you start to feed it with positive things, they're going to be more literate in a financial way. They're going to have more savviness at the business table. They're going to understand how to do the markets, whatever your thing is. But they know how to bring that stuff back and start dropping it down into our young kids. And I think it starts with the youngest as we can go. These curriculums need to change. Man, I can go on and on, but you know what I'm saying.
Yeah. That kind of speaks to also one of the things that, you know, the fierce urgency of now, where King emphasizes the importance of making changes immediately. He criticizes slower approaches to social progress and exacerbates, you know, tranquilizing drug of gradualism. Until the nation addresses the urgent needs of its Black citizens, there will be no peace in society. So it's not so much the fact that the nation needs to address, we need to address ourselves. And one of the things that I say all the time, we as a people, we have to live as the African diaspora. We have to stop saying African-American, Jamaican, Dominican, Latin. We have to stop saying that and say those of us from the African diaspora coming together as one people, because we are one people. But unfortunately, because of what happened during the transatlantic slave trade and then beyond, right, that was done by design, so we wouldn't unify. But if we did, and then came to the, and there are some organizations, smaller, that do some of that, But in mass, we don't do enough for that. Like, that's one of the things. Like, we dreamt, right? We're talking about some plans, like plan to come together as one people, nation building, and to do some stuff, right? Do some stuff. Those are the things that need to be happening, man. So, yeah, no doubt, no doubt. Also, King, he addresses Black Americans to discuss the question of how to achieve justice. Let's talk about that, for example, because, you know, this past year we saw last week, you know, and then over the past year, and then even before that, you know, justice, you know, your shirt says injustice anywhere. What does it say down the bottom? Is a threat to justice everywhere, right? So, you know, ultimately, this speaks to that, you know, and the sad but true, you know, I wonder, and shout out to all my law-abiding police officers that are doing the right thing out there, protecting people and doing the right thing. I have nothing against them. But as they talked about it in the media, they said many of those people that were, like, there were people here in Philadelphia that actually were still currently actively working in law enforcement down there being involved with that stuff. Think about how many people right now could, and then those in the military, those in the reserves, and they got the same people. It's funny how you had all that stuff happen, and then, you know, the same politicians still go inside the Capitol and then vote against, you know, the election, like the election was still a fraud, still after you've seen all that stuff, that mayhem, right? And then you got people that are called down there to now protect the Capitol. I wonder how many of them were actually down there in the rally in the first place, then we just went home, put on their military uniforms, and then began, and now protecting the Capitol. Like, if you go back in time, like from years ago, you had different organizations, you know, we can name them all, you know, white supremacist groups and so on and so forth, that by day, they would be this one person, but then at night, they would put on that uniform or put on that sheet and then do the mayhem, then come back the next day. So it's all interwoven in the fabric of the country. So when we talk about justice, how can we really, and I believe you already said it, Brother Matt, we got to have those seats at the table. We got to have those seats at the table in order to really get justice for all people, you know? And we have to increase that. I mean, talk to that for a second.
I'll jump in a little bit. So we just have to get creative in our thinking. This little device right here is a game changer. They're not doing anything different than they always been doing, but this device is just exposing. You know, when you're in a deficit situation, you have to expose the weakness of those that are, you know, kind of kicking your tail. So, you know, we have to teach ourselves about our rights. We have to understand our rights as they're constituted currently. It is what it is, but it's best to know your rights. And stop, use the example of getting pulled over. You know, as a younger man, you know, we always try to get out of a ticket. Oh, man, come on, you know, cut me a break. We can't do that no more, because cutting you a break gets you pulled out the car and it gets you into all these other different things that we see. Now, it's a transaction. Handle your business, man. I'm not here to argue with you. If you say I ran a stoplight, get my ticket, I'll take my day in court. I'm good. I'm out of here. You know what I mean? Follow your rights. I really, you know, man, I'm sure you have a tough job, but listen, I don't really talk about my day. I'm going to plead the fifth right now. I'm not going to talk about anything, but let's handle this transaction. I'm going to keep it moving. I'm not talking about where I'm going, where I came from, or anything. No, thank you. See you in court. We just have to change our narrative on how we approach these things. As it pertains to these systems, anything that accepts public money is open to public scrutiny. So that's where we need to start looking. Okay, your police force or your educational system is accepting federal dollars. So let's start using some of these letters we have after our name and say, what should you be doing with these federal dollars, and are you doing it? Because you're held accountable to a higher standard if you're taking federal money. As it pertains to those people down in DC, I maintain that in their hearts and minds, they wasn't doing nothing wrong. They felt like this is, I'm living in my privilege, this is the people's house, and I can come in here because I pay for it, I'm a taxpayer, and they felt like they could do whatever they wanted to do. And that's why they were near snitching on themselves, because they had no concept that what I was doing was wrong. That blew my mind.
No, the media and like the reporting, the stuff that they were saying afterwards, justifying what they did, I was like, but once again, privilege, right?
We know better from little kids in our community. Shut up.
Pastor Matt, anything on that?
No, it was well said by Rosario. Only other thing I would say, knowledge of the policies and unity. There are so many things that unify us, but we often focus as a community on what divides us. I often say, and I'll be quoted as saying this, even as a pastor of a Baptist church, there have been many concepts and policies like the Nation of Islam has done to uplift our community. There have been many great things the Black Panthers did to uplift our community. There have been many groups that have done well and had some great ideas, ideologies. Of course, some things messed them up along the way, but there have been many groups that have had some great ideas. And if we came together, we'd be a force to be reckoned with, but we tend to focus on what divides us. And so I think if we are educated and aware of the policies, and we all know that they move the goalposts, as they say. Sometimes they change the rules or distort it. But if you know, you can address what you know and then keep knowing. And then instead of being reactive, we can be proactive once we know what we're dealing with. And then I can't stress enough the importance of unity.
Mac, go ahead. Touched on the nation. And I just wanted to add something to that because that's a very important point that you made. The nation has their own printing press. They have their own land and sources of food. They have their own university and their own scholars. They have their own ritual and rigor before you can become a member of that. And you know, the three of us know a little bit about that. And those are the places and spaces where infiltration had occurred with the Panthers and other organizations. You know, there's a screening process. You know, if you're going to be about this business right here, you know, we have a thing of ours. If you're going to be about this business that of our thing, well, we need to make sure that you're about that business in the way that we make sure you're about that business. And, you know, COINTELPRO is real. It is real. So you got to guard against it. And those that didn't guard against it, we know what the outcome has been. So it's important that we have that too. And they have a standing army. You can call it what you want to call it, but the Fruit of Islam is a protective force to their leader and to their ideology. So you got nations within nations in this country. We just don't have one. We got to work on that. We have it, but you know what I mean? We got to tighten it up.
You took the words out of my mouth, brother. I was about to talk about COINTELPRO the whole nine, but you dropped it. I mean, that's pretty much that thing. So in recognizing the history of that, we need to circle back, right? Whether it be any of those organizations or another organization to organize, that's something that we definitely need to do. There's a way to do it, you know, in my opinion. We can talk about that in a little bit, but I'm gonna show this next little video clip, which is another speech by the great ancestor.
On paper. If I lived in China or even Russia or any totalitarian country, maybe I could understand some of these illegal injunctions. Maybe I could understand the denial of certain basic First Amendment privileges because they haven't committed themselves to that over there. But somewhere I read of the freedom of assembly, somewhere I read of the freedom of speech, somewhere I read of the freedom of press, somewhere I read that the greatness of America is the right to protest far right. So a water hose that's turned us around, we aren't going to let any injunction turn us around. Well, I don't know what will happen now. We've got some difficult days ahead. But it really doesn't matter with me now, because I've been to the mountaintop. I don't mind. Like anybody, I would like to live a long life. Longevity has its place. But I'm not concerned about that now. I just want to do God's will. And he's allowed me to go up to the mountain. And I've looked over. And I've seen the promised land. I may not get there with you. But I want you to know tonight that we as a people will get to the promised land. So I'm happy tonight. I'm not worried about anything. I'm not fearing any man. Mine eyes have seen the glory of the coming of the Lord.
Wow. I mean, so for lack of better terms, that brings chills to me, because he knew he wasn't going to be around that much longer. He alluded to that because he was talking about some real stuff. He had recently, I guess, met with the nation a little bit sometime before that as well. Then the next day after that speech, he was assassinated. He was assassinated. And that was out of Memphis, Tennessee, in support of the black sanitation workers, right? Trying to unify them, trying to get them together, talking about nation building. He was about to, look, that, and they knew they had to get rid of him because he had so many people, unlike some of the other organizations we mentioned earlier, they had followings, but Reverend Dr. had a much larger following, right? And had other people, you know, on the other side listening to him as well. So he was ready to get it going, man. And they took him out, man. Let's talk to that for a second.
Yes, sir. You know, in the doctrine of COINTELPRO, they spoke of, they were wary of the great unifier, those who could electrify the people. And you know, we have people in history that just have that gift, you know, and that ministerial gift that's I'm not getting in your lane over there, Mac, but I know that training, you know, if those who are identified with the gift plus that training and the intellect, he's a triple crown, man. So, you know, there's whispers in the notes and the doctrines that whether it was through the incessant surveillance that he was under, you know, the calls that we're gonna kill you, you know, those kinds of things, or whether it was just his intuitive nature to know that he had maybe a premonition, maybe he had that silent moment with God in his prayer and knew his time was short. But also in that speech, he had a shift. You know, the previous speech, the I Have a Dream speech, there was a shift. He was more nebulous in that speech. He was just talking about general things that we should be doing, you know, to upset this system and make some change. But by the time he got to the mountaintop, he was very specific. He named Wonder Bread. he named specific things that you need to be doing. And he had spoken out on Vietnam during that time. You know, there's a lot of things going on, man. He, like you said, Brother Warren, he wasn't playing no games by that time. He stopped saying Negro and started saying black. Picked up on that. Black people. He wasn't saying Negroes like in 63. He's like saying black people. So the influences was catching up. And he was already powerful in 63. There's no telling where he's going, his trajectory. So they did what they did. Same thing with Mega Evers and the rest. Martin, Malcolm, everybody. That's what they did. They can't do it today. So that's why we got to use these platforms and win.
Yeah. He already dreamed. He dreamt. He talked about the dream. Now he was coming up with a plan. And with that plan, now we begin to do, right? Brother Matt, Pastor Matt, go ahead, Pastor Matt. I'm sorry.
I was just going to say what I appreciate most about that speech, as was already mentioned, he knew his time was at hand. There are many biblical innuendos or references, whether we're looking at Moses, who had gone to the mountaintop and saw the promised land, but God told him he wouldn't make it, but he saw it. And so Martin Luther King Jr. is having that kind of revelation. But he realizes and is saying that there's something bigger than himself. And one of the things we need when we talk about leaders are people that are willing to recognize this is bigger than me. This is bigger than my ideologies. This is bigger than my fame, my finances. We need people that can see the bigger picture. And so I can really appreciate Dr. King on that. I just wanted to mention that because great speech, great orator, great man of God. But what I love most about him is he's a visionary and he was a leader, not a manager, but a leader who inspired people to do more. And so much happened after his assassination. We can look at the riots. While some people say it was self-inflicted damage, but also heroin went to a whole nother level. Then cocaine came in. And not long after King's assassination, the industrial jobs in the major cities start to decline, which for many of our ancestors, that was their source of income. Back up until 1970 or 1975, a black man could make more than some people that went to college. But when they shut those factories down and shut down industrialization, as we talked about earlier, Rosario, not right after King's assassination, all of this happened. Then people are stuck. Then next thing you know, we got the 80s and people are practically dependent on, I'm about to get on a whole nother soapbox, but selling drugs and doing other types of entrepreneurship. So it was such a ripple down effect after his assassination, but he had a dream and it was up to us to pick up the baton and run with it. And I'm not going to say we completely dropped the baton, but I really wish some things would have happened after April 4th, 1968.
You know, Mac, on that, you know, great point you made. I like to get into the granular places and spaces when we talk about those historical places. We never changed the playbook, man. The playbook was given to us to have a singular leader because that's what America is rooted on, a singular leader. So all we did was replicate their playbook and offer up our single leader. And every time they chopped the head off of one of our singular leaders, we didn't change our playbook. Coach, you understand. We didn't go into that playbook and say, well, we need a triple backfill. You know, we need five wide. We just kept running with the one situation. So with Dr. King, as powerful as he was, and his name befits his power, when you topple the king, the people fall and they scatter.
Yeah, defense put eight in the box, and we couldn't run our plays anymore.
Well, that's the only play we had. Every time we kept looking for a one from slavery, as you the one, you know, looking for the one because that's the playbook we were given. Think about this. Contrast that against an African paradigm in your mind. We had a tribal effect. So you couldn't just chop down one. Shaka Zulu came with the horns. We had all kinds of strategies. We came here, we adopted a strategy that was designed for us to fail because they gave it to us. We never designed our own playbook. And that's where we need to be now. The advent of social media has given us a bunch of platforms of people who are doing well in multiple areas. The question is, can we corral together and come up with a better plan and do things at a higher level?
In this speech, he says, he urges his audience to stay together. Unity helped the Egyptian slaves free themselves from bondage, unity, right? And King observes that there's a similar and remarkable power in a collective Black voice. So as long as the movement keeps the focus and attention on the key issue, injustice. So keeping it on the injustice, but doing it as a collective and as one voice. And you just mentioned, I don't get paid for this, for mentioning this, but there's a documentary on TV right now on Netflix called Crack. Have you seen that? Yeah,
I saw it.
Yeah, if you haven't seen it, see that. I mean, I lived it.
Most of us, I grew up in the 80s. I'm younger than y'all. So most of the time, we don't watch it because it's information you already know. But sometimes it's good to hit the refresh button. So I would encourage folks to watch it on Netflix.
Definitely. They could have called Brother Warren or called me. We could have been associate producers.
Absolutely. But it speaks to, like you said, all those industries stop, and then, you know, they dump these things, you know, the drugs and the guns in the hood, and then say, okay, now, and then when they lock you up, then they put you in the other situation because of the 13th Amendment, and now you become working for that land again, right? You're cultivating the land. It's all just part of the plan and whatnot. So, you know, that's why we're doing things like this to elevate the minds of the youth. And I was talking to the news, unfortunately, today in Philadelphia. I think if it continues to go the way it's going, the homicide rate, you know, for young people committing these homicides might be worse this year than it was last year. And think about it, because we're in a pandemic. This is a little off topic, but it's still relevant. We're in a pandemic. Schools are not live to live right now. There's no, like, sports right now, especially, like, in the inner city right here in Philadelphia. And so now kids need something to do. Kids need something to do. And they can't get the jobs like they had before. They need money. I'm not justifying what they're doing, but it's cause and effect. I mean, you know, this is a byproduct of what is going on, right? The crime that's going on right now is a byproduct of, you know, the pandemic, lack of jobs, not being in school, no activities, all that kind of stuff and whatnot, man. So we got to get out of that mindset, though, people. I mean, the parents out there watching this, you know, talk to your young people, know what they're doing all the time and get them right. I mean, we got to get out of this mindset, because if not, we're going to wipe ourselves out. You know, we got to fix this.
That's what they want. They want us to do that.
So if I can add one more thing, and this is going to be awkward coming from a PWI graduate. One of my favorite quotes of Dr. King. So this is a King quote: "Injustice anywhere is a threat to justice everywhere." But another one of my favorite King quotes is, "I fear I am integrating my people into a burning house." Right after King's assassination, all of these PWIs start accepting Black people, and all of these establishments become more and more integrated. And while I love all God's children, let me be clear, I love every person God created, every race, creed, and color, it adversely affected the Black community. I again believe it was no coincidence when these things started happening. And as that happened, in fact, as to be honest, we talked about Tulsa. Many people don't know that community was rebuilt. While that street, Greenwood Avenue, was destroyed, so many things happened, they built up many of those businesses, the schools, the hospitals, so many other things. But now in North Tulsa, the high school that used to be for the most elite and intelligent Black people, Booker T. Washington, Black people can't go because it's a magnet school. Things have changed so much, either through integration or gentrification, that we do not have access to the dream. And so it was almost like if we took a little and we gave away so much. We gained access to certain things, because some of those things that King listed in his dream about little Black boys and Black girls, some of those things have been accomplished. But I feel like we gained a little and we lost a lot. And I don't know, maybe I'm only the one who feels that way. Again, I'm not against integration, but I do recognize it has devastated our communities in many ways.
Absolutely. I've argued against the Brown versus the Board of Education, and I've argued against it. I wasn't for it, because the integral part that they missed was a lot of our civil rights giants came from schoolhouses in the South. You know, W.E. Du Bois taught in a schoolhouse in the South. You know, what they were asking, what they should have asked for, let me just say that, what should have been asked for additionally was equitable funding. You know, the education that was going on was stellar. All you needed was support, books, resources, and money. You know, what was happening was great, but we couldn't have a standalone situation. It just seems like every time we want a standalone situation and leave us alone, well, no. We want to do this. We want to integrate this. We want to need you to combine this with that. Civil rights. Now you have people on the learning and building on the backs of the civil rights movement, but not giving homage to the Dr. Kings and everybody else. You know, you're not lifting as you climb. You know, it's a good phrase. There's people out here that are doing that, lifting, but they're not pulling up. Or you're not even saying in your speech, you know, we got to give credit where credit's due. All of the African-American people, the Black people that did civil rights, is why we're able to have what we have over here in San Francisco. Or this is why we're able to have what we have over here for this section of people, or this group of people, or this group. You know, that's an argument I have in my own place of business where I say, listen, you know, it's okay to be whatever you need to be, do whatever you like to do, but give proper credit. Because if I were writing a paper, you'd call me for plagiarism if I didn't cite my source. You know, that's how I look at it.
All facts, good brother. So we're getting to the last segment, and that's when we talked about the dream, we talked about the plan. So now what can we actually do? Something we talked about, some things we need to do as well, but I'm gonna share my screen again and lay out what I think is a viable option, one of the options we should definitely pursue as a people. So I spoke about this actually in my last broadcast. Can you hear me? So one of the things that we as people from the African diaspora can do, and I mentioned this during my last broadcast, was living through the principles of Kwanzaa, like throughout the year. Because if you think about it, umoja, right? And the language may, you know, some of us, because we're, you know, brainwashed, we can't get into the language. Oh, Umoja, Kujichagulia, Ujima, Ujima, Ania, perfect. You know, Kumba, you know, Imani faith. You know, but essentially, Umoja, organize, is unity, right? Organize, create, or join an organization that is centered on uplifting your culture and our people. We said that. That's something that needs to happen. Kujichagulia, self-determination. Don't be afraid to name, be, or speak for yourself. You can't be afraid of that. You cannot be afraid of that, people, right? Ujima, collective work and responsibility, you know, reclaim and build your community. We just talked about that. You heard several examples tonight. The Asian community, the Jewish community, all these different communities doing that. We can do the same. Along with that, Ujima cooperative economics, create and support Black businesses. Support the businesses. I mean, it may cost a little bit more at these stores, but it costs a little bit more because we don't have enough of them pulling the resources together to be able to go buy things in bulk and in mass. But if we do that, in that spirit, then prices can come down. But we have to start to support them and then build our own mini, you know, Tulsas and Rosewoods and various hoods and so on and so forth. I mean, it's being done in certain places already. I believe down in Atlanta and maybe like in a DMV and things of that nature, you know, in different pockets, right? But we just need more of that. We definitely need more of that. You know, basically staying, you know, having a purpose, you know, to stay vigilant, you know, in the daily purpose of making yourself and your people better. Don't be selfish like crabs in the barrel. Lifting as we climb. Lift each other up, right? Being creative. You know, we created a lot of things before we got here, and still a lot of things while we were here, even during, you know, slavery, even during that, all these inventions and the things that came out of it that we had to do in order to survive, to make that work easier for us. And now doing those things to make work easier for us are now things that are being sold and patented by other people, making millions and millions and millions and billions of dollars off those things that we created in those ideas. Got lights on right now. You know, a little filament inside the light bulb. I mean, you know, how many lights you got in your house? I just bought like 10 light bulbs the other day, right? I like to do this research to find out, are the ancestors, are the people that, you know, the children, the great-great-grandchildren of Lewis Latimer benefiting from that? I don't know. Are they? We speak to it, you know. And don't give up on yourselves. Having faith, right? Having faith, you know. You got to have faith. Got Pastor Mac on here. And listen, I look forward to every Sunday. I mean, shouts out different words and whatnot. You know, I'm getting more. And now, even, you know, Pastor Waller, although I'm not a member, you know, he comes on like every day. I see him pop on Facebook. I'm like listening for that stuff, man, getting words, you know, building up my capacity. You know, each one, teach one. School is always open. I'm learning something every single day, you know, through these like social media platforms and things like that. So, brother, speak to this a little bit, man. Speak about this a little bit here.
Yeah, I'm with you all day, twice on Sunday when it comes to the principles of Kwanzaa. I'd like to consider one other thing to add. You know, one other thing that I would consider to add is we don't have think tank institutions that solve problems for Black people. We go to college, And basically we get ferreted away. They take our top minds, our top intellect, our top skills, and we go into the open market and we go get jobs, which is fine. It's cool. But our institutions, maybe, you know, there's someone that's near and dear to us that used to go to Massachusetts every summer. You know, after he taught at Howard University, he would go to the Woods Hole and do marine biology, which was a think tank. So he was brought in because of his skills, not to take away from his job or his career, but he was brought in maybe a nominal stipend, you know, to respect your expertise, but you were brought in to solve a problem specifically for what your skill set is. I think I'm a pick on you a little bit, Pastor. You know, the church could be a good linkage to maybe show people how to build an institution to maybe, I don't know if it's a special collection or not, Pastor, but, you know, we could bring some of our talent and say, hey, this is a problem in the Virginia area that Black people specifically are suffering from. In my congregation, I have two doctors and three scientists, and, you know, I want this task force. I'm just talking about on a small level. But that's the level we need on the large level to bring our minds back home. We go into HBCUs, it's awesome. But we got to come back home, not just for homecoming. We got to come back home to solve some problems. Can the university set aside some money to bring back esteemed alumni to solve some of our problems? And then roll it out into to our nation and say, hey, the top minds that we have talked about the Constitution, and this is what needs to happen. We've concluded, boom. And there it is in, you know, whatever journal, whatever we do, however you want to roll it out. But we're losing our intellect. And to be so educated, we're using it on everybody else's platforms and bringing it home. That's why I love your platform, Brother Warren, because you are bringing that intellect back home. And we just need to funnel like $25 million into your situation. And we good.
Well, Brother Rosario, if I could just add one thing, the same way I call it black flight of some of our bright individuals. I'm not going to say best and brightest, because we still have some great individuals that come home. It's happening in the church. Whereas at one time, the leaders in the community, the wealthiest African-Americans, they were your deacons, your trustees, your pastors. Now, either they don't have the faith or they go to multicultural churches. And so the same way it's affecting our schools, it's affecting our churches. And so we need a total commitment of everybody. You know, we're going to support, as one of the principals talked about, Black businesses, and commit to coming back home to, I guess, help support and foster Black excellence within our own communities.
Well, that's new information. I mean, I guess, you know, because of, you know, desegregation and all these things, just looking at like schools, we chasing schools and so on and so forth, PWIs and whatever, because, and that's, I mean, go where you go. I mean, I went to HBCU, obviously, you know, go where you go, but, you know, bring something back to the people. And then even the schools, like you said, have to do better. They have to do better. I mean, on one of my previous shows, I learned that a couple of universities, shout out to Clark, shout out to Dr. Chiki Okua, right? And also shout out to one of my old football players, Maurice Suggs, a professor down at Delaware State. They have entrepreneurship programs as a major, right? Like those two schools. I don't know of many schools that have that, but I know those two do. So all of our schools need to have that. Because like you said earlier, a lot of HBCUs, they were created, you know, by other folk, you know, for us to take the top cream of the crop from us, from our schools, to go work for somebody else. Right. And that's what you decide to do. That's fine. Let's work for somebody else. That's cool. But you got to have your have and you got to have your hustle. Right. You got to have that. I work with young people right now. So listen, if you're going to go get that piece of paper, OK, do that. You know, aspire to do that job or whatever. But do something for yourself, too. Don't do that forever. You know, and even though I'm on the backside, on the end of towards my, like, you know, working like career, I guess, or whatever, I plan to live for a long time. I'm trying to live a much longer period of time. But hopefully the Lord, you know, the Most High blesses me with that. You know, so I'm now finally getting even more into those entrepreneurial things. Because for many, many years, I was serving young guys, coaching football, and I had to do what I was doing because I loved the game. But it wasn't just about the X's and O's. It was about making sure I reach those young people and keep them out of jail. That was my main mission, keeping them out of being a product of the 13th Amendment, keeping them out of jail. So now it's time to do something for me. I did something for we. I'm still doing something for we, but now something to do something for me as well. But young people, and there's some dope young people out here to this day. Shout out to Kamal Bloodsoff, if he's listening. He's actually a Bloomsburg alum, one of my old football players. He went there, and now he's doing amazing, amazing entrepreneurial things. I got to get him on here one day. He's doing amazing things worldwide. Bloomsburg. You know, I got to shout him out. He's doing amazing work. And there are several others also, but he comes to mind because he's really doing the daggone thing. He worked for about a year and said, forget that. I'm going to do my thing for myself. And he's doing amazing work, you know, so that's and a lot of young people are doing that right now, and we just need more. We need more, and the energy and the spirit is there. You mentioned like social media and how some of the young people are using the social media and the YouTube and the Instagram and all those kinds of things and building their own little mini nations, you know, virtually and doing that good work and whatnot. But let's keep the culture in mind too. It's not just all about the paper. The paper is good. Paper is power. Paper is power. Yes. But also, we got to put something here too and have knowledge of stuff, because if we don't have that, we ain't going to keep our paper.
Right. You know, I would love to see all of the highly respected HBCUs. I would love to see them have the graduates consider. They need to make a space where Mr. Warner came through CU and he's stellar. I want him to consider staying, because I got this thing over here that's going to pay you on a commensurable level of what you got going on elsewhere. We don't have the consideration. It's like, okay, good job, bye. We don't have anything to make them consider to stay home and work for the common cause of us and pay them what they're worth. But there's no consideration. It's like automatic. See you later, bye. See you later, bye. See you later, bye. I think if you just had if you could get two heads from each university to be like, just stay home. And we got you, salary, the whole nine. You're not missing anything in your life, but come home and work on this. That's major.
Right. Pastor Matt, anything on that?
No, I mean, it's great. As a person who went to a PWI, I try to refrain from addressing HBCU matters because I don't know, and I don't want to speak out of ignorance. But I will speak to us committing to benefiting our own, which was already said. And then the only other thing I want to add, I do recognize it's difficult to ask people to commit to buying Black, supporting Black, and going Black if we ourselves aren't committing to a standard of excellence. And so I do think it is important. And I'm not saying that it's not there, but I think we all have to have a standard of excellence and know that what you do is not just you, but it's a reflection of the total community. And in order for us to build up our community, you got to be the best coach you're ever going to be, the best businessman you're going to be. Even if you're a plumber, you hold the weight of us on your shoulders, and you have to do excellent in all that you do. I fully believe, I often preach, God is a God of excellence. God is not a God of mediocrity. And so if we want people to come back, we also have to uphold a standard of excellence.
Yeah, absolutely. Indeed. So, we're almost at the end of our broadcast. And so right now, what do you guys got going on? Anything in particular? Any products? Any products you want to talk about? You know, shows? Anything? You know, what you got going on? Anybody? Pass?
So I do have a podcast called The Mac Attack Show. It's more of a free-for-all fun conversation. We talk about relationships. We talk about faith, social justice, so many other things. The last episode was actually with an engaged couple, and we talked about being in a relationship during the holiday season. And so it was pretty cool. The next conversation is actually going to be faith-based related, where we're going to talk about God's justice. A lot of people, for example, the unfortunate circumstance of the young lady who got shot at the Capitol, a lot of people say, well, I'm glad she died. She got what she deserved. And some people try to justify that biblically. And so I just want to have a conversation with one of my favorite Old Testament scholars about it. And we're going to put that out there. And then just to speak on projects working on, I have been connected with some amazing brothers back in Petersburg, my hometown. We're called the Petersburg 100. Although it's not 100 people yet, we have a vision of more. And its sole focus is to stop the gun violence in Petersburg. Like you mentioned, all across this country, The murder rates, homicides, shootings have gone up in a pandemic when people are supposed to be in the house. I believe isolation has led to more frustration, stress, anxiety, and post-traumatic stress disorder. And people are killing each other. And a lot of these young brothers have nothing else to do. And so it's been a wonderful thing. Got connected with the mayor, the director of the YMCA, so many other leaders in the community, coaches, and just brilliant people. And we're committed to actually go in the street, talk to these young brothers, get some of the guns off the street. And with that, got connected with the Department of Juvenile Justice, doing a mentor program for kids on probation and parole. So many of the mentoring programs I've seen, and I'm not knocking it, but so many of them have been for the kid that has the 3.5 and is guaranteed to go to college, well-to-do family. And I was like, you know, what are we doing for the kids that are considered quote unquote at risk? So we're being intentional about reaching out to those kids who are already in the system, and we're trying to get them out of the system because recidivism is real. So those are my major projects right now.
Recidivism is definitely real, brother. Recidivism is definitely real. And thank you for your work, man. Thank you for your hustle and your grind, man. A lot of projects you're working on right now, good brother. Brother Rosario, what you got going on, brother?
Oh, man, I used to be hustle man forever, entrepreneurial, did a lot of real estate, a lot of things in the past. What I'm doing today is I'm really getting my voice and my place is razor sharp. So I actually went back to school. I'm finishing a second master's this May, and I'm looking into either a PhD or an EDD program. Being in my 50s, man, I don't have time to really play. So I'm playing around with what I'm doing, but I'm doing it for us. I feel like I have more to offer in academia, so that's what I've been doing. Aside from that, I've been increasing my speaking visibility. So on platforms like yours, Brother Warren, I've been doing some financial literacy. I've spoken on subjects such as police reform and what that looks like with actionable kind of steps. You know, and I'm encouraging people to dig into the teeth of the way things are written and be informed on how to make substantive change. You know, I'm tired of just glossing over it conversationally. I want to get into the teeth of a matter and be able to say, listen, on page 654, subsection 2, and the footnotes, that's where they hide those things. So working as an aspiring scholar in multiple areas, that's my footprint that I want to leave. So right now I'm digging in the crates and digging in those books, and I'm emerging slowly, but I'll have more to say as I continue on, but I'm out here speaking and saying what I need to say.
Absolutely, man. And you know, I love you, man. So keep on doing what you're doing. I love both of y'all, man. But you know, I've been knowing you since like 87, right? Since you was a young pup, you know, trying to come into frat and all that and everything, man. It's amazing seeing, you know, how we've all, you know, evolved to the people, to the men, to the scholars and the ministers and all the things that we've evolved to, man, over the years, man. So pretty much right now for me, through my organization, Peace, and to please educate all children equally. I got a series coming up, series of workshops, and I got a couple of contracts actually, you know, going on right now with a couple of the charters here in Philadelphia area. You know, shout out to them, their CEOs. I will put them on blast because I want to surprise their people because the check hasn't been cut yet. So, but still, it's still it hasn't been cut yet, but I know it's coming though. But I will say the workshop is called Intentional Teaching, the Intersectionality Between Teaching, Race, Equity, and the Standards. Because essentially, you know, we have to teach the babies, but we have to teach the teacher. We have to teach the teacher to unpack a lot of our unbiases and the history of race in this country and so on and so forth before we can start teaching kids. You know, we can't teach somebody that we don't even respect or know anything about and then understand why we feel the way that we feel. And, you know, a lot of it is kind of tied to things we saw last week, we've seen in history, so on and so forth. So the workshop is going to be very, very engaging. I've done it before, you know, other places, you know, I just didn't monetize it, so now I'm monetizing that. So shout out to those organizations that have definitely reached out to me, allowed me to come into their space, and I'm looking to engage with them that way. So the other stuff, I'll wait a little while before I talk about the other stuff, but that's coming next, coming to a space near you in the Philadelphia area and during the month of February. So,
Brother Warren, I hope I'm not out of line, but I actually have a show request. I would love to hear from educators on how virtual learning is affecting urban youth specifically.
Okay. Well, we actually did that. We did a show like that. We did do one. You missed it. But I'll send you that link. We could do another one because that was a few months.
You did one. I think I remember watching it now.
Yes.
Because it's an interesting plight, and there's levels that continue to come from it. Like some kids, they were fine the first 3 to 6 months, but now it's like it's taking a toll on them and they're zoomed out. So I was just curious. But yeah, I do remember.
We need to do another one. As a matter of fact, I reached back out to that panel. Maybe we can come back again because that was a couple of months ago. That was towards the beginning of this school year. So maybe now we're into the second half of the year. We can do it again and talk about some of the changes, some of the updates, because it still exists and there's varying things that are going down. And yeah, so we need to go back to it, definitely. But I'll send you the link, and I'll put the link here on my page. My YouTube page where all those videos are housed also.
And cool. I would be curious to see the difference between private school, charter schools, and public schools and how they're navigating the virtual learning.
Yes. And we had all three on the call. We had a suburban school, we had a district school, we had a private school. Shout out to all those leaders of those amazing schools. We had some of each on that call. So, and I've actually, other than the private school, I've worked in all those schools as well. So, and then even schools behind in incarceration facility where I currently like serve a little bit right now. So we had a little bit of this, a little bit of that. But I'm gonna reach back out to them because you made that request. Reach out to these young ladies. I know they're very, very busy. I'm gonna see if they want to do it again and when they can do it again after February. Because I got something smashing coming in February. You know, talking about Black history, although, you know, Black history is 365. I mean, you know, but because of that month, I'm gonna focus on that. But I got some amazing college professionals supposed to be on tap for that. So
cool.
I gotta get them all right.
I'm gonna leave you with this, Brother Warren. I'm gonna leave you with this. I'm the chair of DEI at my school, and I'm the director of climate and safety. And I have a budget, so I need to see you March, April, or May.
Oh, absolutely.
We'll talk more.
Absolutely.
We'll talk more, man. So listen, man, another appeal I want to make. This being Dr. Martin Luther King's birthday, I'll never forget a few years ago, a coworker of mine, son came to the job, and I asked the young man, you know, why aren't you in school? I already knew the answer, but I wanted to see what he was going to say. And the young man said, I don't know, somebody got shot. Kind of hurt me to the core. The parent was embarrassed. Then I realized how much our young people don't know about Dr. King. So if there are any parents watching this, especially of school-aged children, I would ask you and encourage you, sit down and talk to your children about Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. and the Civil Rights Movement. Thank you.
Absolutely. And on that note right there. The inspiration for this entire show this evening was the ancestor, the late great, Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King, who was born on this day, not on the 18th, but actually born on the 15th of January. So we're going to recognize him. Anybody who's been to birthday parties in the hood, you know this song. Let's go. Let's get it. Listen, shout out to everybody out there, Facebook world, YouTube world, Pastor Matt, Dave, love you, Q-Sai forever, and stay on for a second. Everyone else, thank you for coming out. God bless you, and good night.